with this novel and with this experience. If it happens to sell and people happen to love it, I'm all the much better off. But it's already a winner to me. It's already a huge success because in my heart, in my mind, and in my soul, I feel great about it. And isn't that a great place to be as a writer? When you finish a project, you're not filled with anxiety or worry, but you just feel good about the process.
Welcome to the Stark Reflections on Writing and Publishing podcast. There has never been a better time for writers. More information, options, and opportunities are available to you, but navigating these requires insight. Join Mark Leslie Lefebvre as he draws upon more than a quarter century of experience as a writer, a bookseller, and a trusted book industry consultant to explore and reflect on the writing and publishing landscape to help you make informed choices on your writer journey.
Hello, Reflectives, and welcome to episode 244 of the Stark Reflections podcast. This is your host, Mark Leslie Lefebvre. Today is going to be a rambling reflections episode, and I'll explain that later. But first, before we get into my personal update, etc., etc., let's hear a word about this episode's sponsor. Do you hear that? It's a clock ticking on the wall. My mom's kitchen. I'm sitting in a chair that kind of squeaks when I move a little. I mean, it has a little bit something to do with the fact that I'm very well nourished. But I'm in a room where you can probably hear a bit of an echo. There's the sound of cars driving on the street beside me. I'm not in my regular spot where I normally record the podcast. And the reason I'm calling attention to the poor audio quality of this podcast is because if you're looking for professional narrators who use actual studios and professional settings to get audiobooks produced, you can look for them at Findaway Voices. There's two opportunities, two options, two ways that you can do that. You can use Findaway Marketplace, which launched this year, to find a professional narrator, or you can do the old sort of project management style where you fill out a form. Oh, there's the refrigerator that just turned on behind me in the kitchen. Yeah, not going to get that when you work with a professional narrator for Findaway. But you fill out a form that says what you're looking for, and an employee at Findaway Voices will go through the thousands of narrators available to find you, between 5 and 10 of the best narrators that they think would suit your project's needs. So you can DIY it and go scouting for your own narrators in Findaway Marketplace. You can use Findaway to help you find a professional narrator, that more hands-on guided. Or, if like me, there are narrators that you work with directly, you can get them to send you the final professionally produced audio, unlike this one, and you can upload the audio to Findaway. And then you decide where and how and for what price your audiobooks are going to be available. Because the great thing with Findaway is they allow you the choices and the options as an indie author. So if you want to see how you can control your audiobook destiny as an independent author, you can check out Findaway Voices over at starkreflections.ca/findaway. Well, that is the sponsor portion of the podcast, but now it's the patron portion, and I have a couple patron mentions. I first want to welcome S.W. Miller to the Patreon or patron fold over at Stark Reflections for supporting the podcast. Shane, welcome to the podcast. I sent you a note just to make sure I'm linking to the proper website for S.W. Miller. .com or whatever the URL was. I think that's what it was. But Shane, welcome to Patreon of Stark Reflections podcast. I want to say also hello and hey, how's it going to Maddie, who adjusted her monthly patron fee. Thanks Thanks for sticking around, Maddie, and for all the support, and obviously jumping in on many of those monthly patron calls. And I'm going to sneak in another episode soon for the last chat that we just had, last week, I believe. But I didn't get a chance to edit it in and get it into the feed. But yes, and a special, special thank you to all of the folks who support this podcast over at patreon.com/starkreflection. So welcome, Shane. Thank you, Maddie, and everyone who is a patron of the podcast. Really means a lot that you support this podcast. It helps pay for the time, my time, in producing this show, which I love so much. And I'm so excited that I have not yet missed a single weekly episode that comes out on Fridays every week. Sometimes if you're paying attention, it's in the RSS feed Thursday, but the show notes go live on Friday at 12:01 a.m. Haven't missed a single week. I have, in fact, included extra episodes, because if you're doing your math with your fingers and toes, the podcast launched in January of 2018, and this is episode 244, but I think math would dictate that it really should be 235 or something like that. I'm not sure how many extra episodes. I really should do the math one day. But I also want to say a special thank you to all of my listeners, because the podcast cracked 100,000 listens weeks and weeks ago, and I haven't even paid attention to where we are with that. So just appreciate the fact that you, I'm talking to you, the person listening to this podcast right now, greatly appreciate you. So thanks for being with me. In terms of comments from recent episodes, I was so tickled pink when I saw on the Twitter sphere Edwin Downward, author, saying, I've been revisiting the question of an email list, and here comes Mark Leslie with a guest on his Stark Reflections podcast, actually talking about ways to build a welcome sequence. And I have to say, that episode with Holly Darling HQ, which is episode 243, yeah, see, I can do the math, was a fantastic episode. I loved chatting with Holly, not just because she's awesome and a Canadian, but just her, I love her style, and it was really great. And I still haven't done my homework. I'll explain that in my personal update, why I haven't gotten my homework. But also a special thank you to the Alliance of Independent Authors, who tweeted out that episode with Holly Darling and email sequences. And they said, looking to improve your author mailing list, find out why a welcome sequence is so important in this podcast via Mark Leslie. And yay, love the good folks at the Alliance of Independent Authors. And was so tickled that they shared that. So thank you, Edwin. And thank you, awesome Alliance of Independent Authors. For a personal update, I am, as you heard in the Findaway, unless you skipped the ad read part of the podcast, but I'm in my mom's kitchen in Levac, Ontario, which is about 45-minute drive northwest of Sudbury, Ontario. And I had to rush here Friday night. I was actually in the United States at a sort of a mini large author mastermind. And my mom, I got a call from a friend who said there was an issue. The healthcare workers would come in to see my mom, who lives on her own. And there was an issue with her breathing and her blood pressure. And they wanted to get the paramedics to take her into the hospital. And I was in the U.S. I wasn't able to get back until the next day. It was my scheduled flight, just the way that it worked out with the COVID screening and stuff like that, that it was easier just to continue on the existing flight I had. But what I did is I rented a car from Pearson Airport in Toronto, Ontario, which is where I was landing, and I drove straight up to Sudbury. Now, my flight was delayed by 4 hours, which was very frustrating, because I did get the call from the nurse in the ICU that my mom was in, that they were worried about they might have to intubate her, and my mom has a DNR, and I had to explain that she had a DNR. But that, it was just a challenging situation, because they would have called me, and I was going to be in the air when that potentially came up. So a little bit stressful, a little bit stressful. And anyways, I landed around 8 p.m. local time, Eastern time, in Toronto Pearson Airport. Managed to get through really quickly, which was fantastic. And thanks for the Nexus card. That's a really great thing. Rented a car, drove straight up to Sudbury, got in at 1 in the morning. And I've been here with my mom, who is still in the hospital. She's not in the intensive care unit anymore, but she is still having trouble with breathing. We know she has obstructive sleep apnea, and that she must have had it for a long time, and that must have caused the lack of oxygen, and that's still a major concern because she's got some delirium and oxygen issues. And I've spent most of my days since Friday in the hospital with her for most of the day, and then trying to get some work done in the early, early wee morning hours and late at night. But of course, by the time I get home, I am exhausted. Yeah, so the audio sound, I did end up picking up a nano Blue Yeti mic, because I knew after the first couple days I was going to be here for a while, trying to figure things out with my mom in terms of her care and stuff like that, and even just what's going on in the hospital, because I'm her only family. There's no one really here but me, and I live 6 hours away. So what I did is my awesome partner Liz met me in Barrie, Ontario, which was not quite halfway, but close to halfway, on Sunday afternoon with some clothes for me, my own blood pressure medication, and my contact lenses, and I only had clothes for Texas. I only had warm clothes. I didn't have winter clothes, and I was coming up to mid-northern Ontario, I should say, but it had snowed, and I was out there shoveling my snow in my, in my sports coat and dress pants and dress shoes with no gloves, thinking, yeah, it might be good to have some. So Liz met me, fortunately, packed a whole whack of nice clothes for me and things that I would need. But I ended up, I had to purchase a Wi-Fi hotspot and a mic, this microphone, this mini microphone, because it's way better than the crappy laptop mic, of course. And I'll probably end up using that for travel because it's nice and small and it's on a little stand. And my regular Blue Yeti is on an arm, my desk. And detaching it and putting it on the stand, I know it doesn't take that long, but it's kind of a pain. I like the setup the way it is, and now I have a travel mic. And the travel mic was only $79. So again, it's probably not as high quality as the other one. And probably what's affecting the audio quality more than anything is that I'm in a kitchen and there's a lot of echo here. What I should have done is I should have relocated to another spot, but I'm just so tired. I just wanted to sit down and do this. And so that's one of the other reasons I didn't end up editing. I've got a few episodes in the can, as well as the patron roundtable, which we did last week or the week and a half before. But I do like to edit those. And I didn't have the time to do the editing, so I am just doing a rambling reflections. Other personal update stuff that's not so personal about stuff that's going on in with the family crisis. In writing news, I was absolutely thrilled when Deanna Hart, D.F. Hart, my co-author of Accounting for Authors, which comes out Tuesday, April 12th, when she pointed out that we had a number one hot new release flag on Amazon for the book. And it's funny because we're publishing this through Draft to Digital, and Amazon doesn't tell Draft to Digital the pre-order numbers and we're doing this because of the payment splitting option, but they don't tell Draft to Digital the pre-order numbers. They'll all just show up on the day of, so on the 12th we'll see. So I have no idea how many. I know how many we've pre-sold at Apple and Kobo, because I can see the Apple and Kobo pre-order numbers there, but for Amazon, I'm assuming it's more than a handful if we got that awesome number one new release tag. So that's really exciting. We are we heard back from a whole bunch of early readers with some feedback and making some sort of last minute changes, but that's pretty much locked and loaded and ready to go, and I'm excited about that. Julie Strauss and I, working on Lover's Moon, we wrapped up the first draft of that, and I am so thrilled with that novel. We've gotten that off to our editor, and there's going to be a bit of back and forth through April and maybe early May, because that comes out May 24th, which is Victoria Day here in Canada. And there's a Rush reference for that. If you're a Rush fan, you know that everyone would gather on the 24th of May, sitting in the sands to watch the fireworks display, dancing fires on the beach, singing songs together. Though it's just a memory, some memories last forever. That's from Lakeside Park, although if you're a Rush fan, I didn't have to tell you that. If you're not a Rush fan, too bad I forced Rush on you. It's my podcast, what are you going to do? Anyway, so that May 24th is when Lover's Moon comes out, and I was telling my mom about it, and she's so thrilled because she has told me my entire life, Mark, why do you write scary stuff all the time? Why don't you write a nice book? And by nice book, she meant romance, because pretty much romance is the only genre my mom reads. So I'm so thrilled. I can't wait till she sees that I did write a romance novel. Well, I mean, I wrote half of a romance novel, and I would not even have been able to do it without the help of Julie. So I'm pretty excited about that. Speaking of Julie, I just want to recommend, if you haven't listened to the Best Book Ever podcast, I just listened to episode 82. 92, I should say, on the drive in from Levac to Sudbury. My mom lives in Levac, and it's a 45-minute drive north of Sudbury. And her guest on episode 92 talked about Kate Stayman London's book, One to Watch. And I just got the audiobook on Kobo, and I can't wait to listen to it. I'll probably be listening to it in part on my daily, almost 2 hours on the road back and forth between Sudbury and Levac. And of course, when I go back south, that's a good 5 to 6 hour hike that I can listen to it. And it was such a great interview. So not only did I put that on my to read list, but Matt Haig's The Midnight Library, which I've seen kicked and punted around for years, but it wasn't until her guest, and I'm drawing a blank. I'm sorry, I can't remember what her guest's name was. Let me see if I can find that, because hey, why not? If you're listening to this, you can hear that. Leah Carey was the guest, and she is actually the host. She's a sex and intimacy coach and host of the podcast Good Girls Talk About Sex. A great conversation between Julie and Lee, or Leah. And my apologies to Lee/Leah for getting it wrong. But great conversation because Leah, I'll say, described what The Midnight Library was about. And in such a compelling way that after all these years of hearing people raving about it but never saying what it was about, she described what it was about. And I had to pick it up. And so you have to listen to episode 92 of that podcast if you want to know what it's about. Or about this awesome, awesome book, One to Watch, which I just purchased and I'm looking forward to listening to. But that is it for my lengthy, rambling, personal update for this episode. I decided to ramble about a few things. Now, these are a few things I've been talking to. I do a lot of consultations and coaching with authors, and even spent some time in person with a bunch of awesome authors last week. And there was just, I guess because I've spent a lot of time in my head this past week on the highway, sitting in the hotel room, sitting in the hospital room with my mom. And a lot of these things have been going through my head. So I thought this rambling reflection are just going to be a few sort of key things that I've been talking to authors about, that I've been thinking about and thought might be important to share with you, dear, dear listener. So let's just play the little bumper and get right into that main portion, shall we? Yes, 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 we shall. One of the first things I wanted to talk about, and maybe I've talked about this on the podcast, I actually can't remember if I've reflected on it, but I have talked with many, many authors about this, and it's about reviews. We all know the importance of reviews. And we worry about reviews. But I think we often worry sometimes about the wrong things. You know, we want all 5-star reviews. And if it's a 4-star, we feel like it's a slap in the face. And oh my God, what if it's a 3-star? Well, let's look at it from the reader perspective. 5 means this book walks on water, right? Then it can do no wrong. It's the best thing ever, ever, ever. You know, 4 is really amazing, really, really good. And 3 is it's good, I liked it. There's nothing wrong with good, I liked it. There is nothing wrong with it. But we take that as a personal affront and get our noses out of joint when our review average is low or whatever that is, or we're not getting only 5 stars. I would argue that if you got only 5 stars, you're not popular enough to have been successful enough to have reached some of the wrong readers. And I know that's not a good thing. Reaching the right readers is paramount. But when you sell a lot more, you're more likely, based on the algorithms, etc., to have your books picked up by people who are not the ideal readers. And oftentimes, yes, they may not like your style, they might not like something about it, or they get all political and because you mentioned something that is against their beliefs, like, I don't believe in gravity, so then they give you a one-star review and stuff like that. Like, I don't believe in science or gravity or anything like that. So that's neither here nor there. That's going to happen. But when it comes to lower reviews and one star and two star and maybe some of the three star reviews, I call it the pineapple on pizza principle. Gotta love my peas, apparently. But I did write a couple books with lots of peas in them. 7 Peas of Publishing Success. And why didn't I put the pineapple on pizza principle in there? The alliteration was just too much to bear. But this is when I say something like, I love pineapple on pizza. And I actually do. I love pineapple, hot peppers, and you can throw in mushrooms and maybe green peppers or some other vegetable. It's a great vegetarian pizza, which is more accessible for more people. And it's got the hot and spicy combination with the sweetness of the pineapple and the cooling effect of the pineapple. Phenomenal kind of pizza. But just me talking about pineapple on pizza has probably really turned off a number of listeners, because I would give pineapple on pizza 5 stars. You might give it 1 or not even want to give it a star because you couldn't even think about it. And that's what happens with books sometimes. It's not that the book is bad or good. It's that the reader didn't particularly care for it because of the pineapple. Because they didn't like the toppings you put on your pizza. Not that it was a bad book. And I think that the pineapple principle helps us realize that when you see a spread of reviews on a book, that it's more realistic that not everyone is going to like it. So you can talk about pineapple on pizza, you can talk about making a peanut butter and jam sandwich, what goes on top, the peanut butter or the jam. You will get people getting really violently excited about what is right and what is wrong. You talk about whether or not if you put ketchup on your food or not, and whether or not you spread it over top of the food or put it in a little puddle for dipping, potentially with your fries, etc. Whether or not cheese curds and gravy go on top of French fries, which is the poutine delicacy here in Canada. That principle, those changes, are really just reflections of people's different tastes. It doesn't mean the book is good or bad. Typically, I mean, sometimes it can be, oh my God, this author can't spell or put a sentence together. That's a little bit different. But I just mean in general, when you see that spread, I always look at it and think, oh, okay, I guess it's not for them. Chacun son goût, as we say in French, to each his own. And I don't say it in French very well. But that's pineapple on pizza principle is important. So when you're looking at reviews, you got to take things with a grain of salt and understand that sometimes your pineapple or your toppings on your pizza were just not appreciated by every single reader. And that is okay. It is not the end of the world, unless you're allergic to pineapple, of course. The other thing that I think authors get excited about or too nervous about or beat themselves up about, and this bothers me a lot, is something I call marketing FOMO. And it's the belief that they have to be marketing all of the time. Yes, sort of, that's true. But we also have this misperception that everyone else is marketing properly, or everyone else has marketing support, and I'm the only one who doesn't have it, or I'm the only one who doesn't have my crap together. I'll tell you one thing that I've done recently, I've shared this a lot with authors I've been talking to lately, is understanding and realizing my own strengths and my own weaknesses. And I can tell you, having experimented and played with BookBub ads and Facebook ads and Amazon ads, that there's one thing I can guarantee you. If I have $500 to spend on an ad like that, like a Facebook ad, for example, I can guarantee you that at the end of this run, Facebook is going to walk away with $500 of my dollars. That I can guarantee you 100%. What I can't guarantee you is that that $500 is actually going to be useful to me in any way other than wasting a bunch of my time. Because for me, the marketing is twofold. I can spend $500, but I will also have to spend many, many hours, which could add up to $500 worth of labor when you think about an hourly rate, working on the analytics for those ads that I'm not good at. And just spending that money to do the ad, just to say I'm doing the ad because everyone's doing ads and I need to do ads, is throwing that money away. It may not be throwing all of it away because some of the ads may be effective in some ways to help me reach new readers. I get that. But when I think about the marketing, I've been just thinking about stuff I've done lately, which is remembering, and I remember Dean Wesley Smith saying this, that the average print book, which most people still read, by the way, most people who read print books. I don't care if you've sold a million ebooks. I don't care if your Kindle Unlimited page reads or put you into a six-figure author territory. The reality is that most people who read print books, and we need to understand that. So we still have so much more room to grow when it comes to ebooks. But the average print book, getting back to my first point that Dean talked about, was the average print book is read by 6 or 7 different people because it gets passed and handed and shared and loaned. And then it's on a shelf and someone else picks it up or gets resold through a used bookstore or whatever. I mean, the average book on a Kindle or Kobo or Nook, for example, is only typically going to be read by one person or maybe two on average because there may be a shared family account, etc. But that's interesting because when you have a book on a device like that, it's not as visible. It's just there. When you have a physical book that can be handed and held up in front of cameras, that can be passed and put in other people's hands, the print book is in and of itself a marketing device because it's visible. People can flip it over, they can talk about it, they can use it as an object, they can see it, it's there. I can look at my phone right now and I can't see any of the thousands of books I have on Audible and Kobo app and the Book Funnel app and the Authors Direct app and all the other apps that I have on my phone. I can't see them, I just see a phone, or I just see my Kindle, or my Kobo, or my Nook, or my iPad, whatever it is. When I see a book, I see the book. So take that $500 and think about investing that $500 in a different kind of marketing that's not going to give me measurable cost per clicks and all that other crap, but it's going to give me longer term visibility and the potential, if I get these $500 worth of books into the hands of readers, that marketing could last longer. Because here's the thing. When I'm paying Facebook or Amazon or BookBub or whatever, my ad, my book cover is only visible while they're pulling money from my pocket or about to pull money from my pocket because of the impression and click. But it usually requires, here's my credit card, here's some money. Okay, show it to people and give me, and maybe I get something for it. I only get the visibility while I'm paying. This other investment of shipping books to people, I get the benefit of those on an ongoing basis, even long years after I stopped paying. It's no surprise if you're a longtime fan of this show or listener of this show, at least. You don't have to be a fan, a listener. I'm fine. I'm cool with that if you keep listening. But you're probably aware of the fact that I think long term. I think about the long game. Yeah, I get stuck in the minute like everyone else, but I do think about the long term, and I do play the long game. And so when I think about those physical books, I know I'm not going to be able to measure them, but I know they're out there doing their job. And I've seen the evidence, and I know it's only anecdotally, but I've seen the evidence years later of what physical products can bring in terms of fans and readers who remember you because of those physical entities. So one of the strategies I've used is looking at people on social media, booktubers, and bookstagrammers and book talkers and people who love holding up physical objects. They don't want to hold up an iPad or a Kobo or a Kindle or a Nook. They want to hold up a physical object. So I've invested money in trying to find the right people to ship physical products to. Even if they don't rave about the book or show it online, they've got a book, and if they're a book nerd, they maybe just gave it to someone who maybe would appreciate it. And that could come back to haunt me in a positive way. I'm not counting on any of those things going viral. I'm counting on getting the books out there, putting them into the hands of potentially the right kind of readers, the right kind of book lovers, and hoping that that long-term magic can happen. I'm not waiting for any magic bullet. I'm not waiting for any magic viral thing to happen. I'm just putting stuff out there and thinking, hey, I had $500 to spend on marketing. Am I going to really gung-ho it into a two-week period or something so I can have a whole bunch of people see my book on Amazon? Or am I going to spend that $500 in a way that is going to mean my books may be seen by people for a lot longer and not just a thumbnail on a screen? So that's sort of my marketing FOMO rambling reflection, but it's just about different ways of looking at the expenditures for marketing. And again, it's not measurable. So I can't come in with scientific evidence and say, do this and do that and you get this percentage and everything works. I'm just looking at some of that longer term thing. I'm almost even looking at the karmic value of the universe, which is a little woo-woo, but it's something I truly believe in. I believe that every single success that I have has come from putting good out into the world, working really hard. And sometimes those things can come back to haunt you in a positive way. The next thing I wanted to reflect on, sort of getting to the end of it, is writing fast or writing with passion. Maybe I should call it the fast or the furious, meaning because furious is passion. Does that work? Tell me, word nerds. Tell me, did I do okay with that? But I see authors beating themselves up because they believe they should write fast or they're not writing fast enough. And that bothers me a lot because oftentimes the people beating themselves up for not writing fast are writing faster than most people. And they don't realize it because they're you know, not doing a book a month or some incredibly almost impossible procedure. I mean, if someone is capable of doing that and not burning themselves up, I love that and I'm so happy for them and great for them and even better for their readers, right, who don't have to wait as long. But if you can only write one book a year, you can only write one book a year. Own it. It's okay. You don't need to apologize for it. You don't need to, I mean, unless you set up reader expectation that they would get a book every quarter and you're only able to deliver a month, well, okay, you do have to and should apologize to your readers for that, because if you set an expectation and then changed it, yeah, well, you made a promise and you didn't fulfill that. But don't apologize to other writers. Don't apologize to yourself. If you've found the speed at which you write and it works for you, you go with it, whether it's fast, whether it's slow. To me, what's more important is that you're writing the passionate stories that you want to write. I was just listening to the Six Figure Author podcast, and Lindsay Baroker was talking about recently writing the kind of book she just loves to write. But then she was, you know, because she is a very smart, business-minded woman, she put a note out to her readers asking, hey, do you want more of this? And if they buy it and if they want it, she will, of course, write more. And that's perfect, because writing more of it while enjoying, it's the kind of stuff she loves to write. And if they love to read it, then that's a match, a marriage made in heaven. But too often, we forget about the passion. Too often, we forget about the things we enjoy doing. And here's the way that I look at it. And I've really come to this realization as I've embraced writing in the Canadian Werewolf series, and I've embraced the wonderful experience of co-authoring Lover's Moon with Julie Strauss, is at the end of the day, if Lover's Moon is a flop and nobody buys it, and even, I'm sad to say, but even if my diehard fans are annoyed because I took a bit of a divergent tactic in this book, although it was requested by some of my readers, and it does lead to some back characters, stories, and introduces some characters that will become prevalent as the story continues. So it seems like an aside, but it's really a hidden, it's a hidden indicator of things to come. If it's a flop, I still think it was a success, because I honestly had endless amounts of fun writing it, and it was such an amazing learning experience for me as a writer that I don't care. I'm happy with this novel. I am so happy with this novel and with this experience. If it happens to sell and people happen to love it, I'm all the much better off. But it's already a winner to me. It's already a huge success, because in my heart, in my mind, and in my soul, I feel great about it. And isn't that a great place to be as a writer? And when you finish a project, you're not filled with anxiety or worry, but you just feel good about the process. I love the process of writing. Of course, I love the process of having written, but I also love when I'm in the groove and in the moment and I'm feeling the scene and I'm putting it out onto that digital page. There's nothing like that rush. There's nothing like that experience. And yes, the money is awesome, but the writing itself needs to be awesome first. And so when I think about writing fast or writing speeds or release strategies, etc., I want to remind myself that I should always be writing with purpose and I should be writing with passion. And for me, maybe that doesn't work for you, but for me, that gives me the intrinsic reward. That gives me the thing I need. That's the dopamine rush. Yeah, okay, it'd be pretty cool, the dopamine rush of seeing tens of thousands of sales on release week, or seeing it tracking to number one in the overall stores or in its category, etc. Yeah, that's always nice, and I'm not going to poo-poo that, because it feels good. It feels good to see your book trending and tracking. I talked about it earlier in this podcast. I'm not going to lie and pretend I'm above that. I'm not at all. I'm a sucker for getting excited about my dashboard, just like anyone else. I'm a sucker for seeing that my book is trending and getting all excited that, you know, the pre-orders must be high. But if I didn't enjoy the writing, that would almost feel odd. It would almost feel like something disconnected from myself, because this process of producing the book was so satisfying and so rewarding. So I want you, dear listener, to think about your why, your reasons, the things that you get up for in the morning when it comes to your writing and when it comes to your plans as a creative person, as a writer, as a publisher, as a person who wants to get those words out into the world. What is it that truly, deeply, and intrinsically satisfies you? I would argue that you should make that the priority over any of those other things, any of the FOMO, any of the frustrations about other things. And I'm not saying do what you love and the money will follow. I'm saying do what you love and the love will be there, regardless of anything else that happens. That's not a good little catchphrase to put on a little mug or anything, but I've never been good at that. What I am good at, apparently, or I'm very proficient at, is rambling and going without a script, which is what I've done for the last little while. Thank you, dear listener, for letting me ramble. Well, I was going to ramble anyways, but if you're still listening, it seems like you're allowing me to ramble in your ear. I appreciate that. That is the end of episode 244. As I said, I do so appreciate you, dear listener. If you like this podcast, you can support it, as mentioned earlier, over at patreon.com/darkreflections, or you can leave a review on the podcatcher of your choice, or Even better yet, share this podcast with someone that you think may find value in these stark reflections. And so, dear, dear listener, until next episode, this is Mark Leslie Lefebvre wishing you great writing and good stark reflections.
Thank you for listening to the Stark Reflections podcast. You can find show notes for each episode at starkreflections.ca.
The music for this podcast, Laser Groove, was composed and produced by Kevin MacLeod. Check out more of Kevin's great music at incomptech.com.